The Historical Society on BCTV is supported by the Highlands at Wyomissing.
Hello and welcome to the monthly program of the Historical Society of Berks County. I'm your host, George M. Meiser IX, President Emeritus of the Historical Society of Berks County. It should be noted that this program is telecast live on the first Wednesday of each month at 7. It repeats Friday at 10, Saturday at 6, and Sunday morning at 9. Welcome all to our June the 6th, 2012 BCTV program. Seated to my right is Joshua Blay, Curator and Associate Director of the Historical Society.
Hey, George.
And seated to his right is Kimberly Brown, Society Archivist and Library Director.
Hi, George.
Hi. And beside Kimberly is John Bartley, who appears to bring us news about the upcoming
Antiques in the Valley,
an annual antique show held at the Oley Valley High School. We're pleased to have you with us, John.
Our museum, Henry Janssen Library, and museum store are open Tuesday through Saturday, 9 to 4. Please be apprised, we won't be having a live program in July, so we will be closing at 2 o'clock on the 3rd of July and be closed 4th for Independence Day. Our museum store has a large inventory in Reading and Berks County histories and a lot of craft and toys. Members receive an extra 10% on most museum store items, and an extra 10% this month in June on baskets created by our own Vicki Hefner and also our very popular Berks County Long Rifles and Gunmakers book related to our exhibit of a couple years ago.
Yes.
We remind viewers that for $55 a year, you can be one of us, a member of the Historical Society of Berks County. Membership in the Society includes our prize-winning quarterly magazine, The Historical Review of Berks County. Membership includes unlimited use of the museum and library. And it also includes, I believe, a free ticket for the Four Centuries tour.
Yep, one free ticket for our very popular Four Centuries tour, a $30 value.
A $30 value, yes. For a $55 membership, you certainly can't beat that.
Certainly not.
Let me see. Incidentally, family memberships all living in the same house are $65 a year. Join and become one of us.
And while we're on the subject of membership, George, we remind the viewers at home that Berks Community Television, BCTV, is a tough survivor and a unique entity in that it's interactive. You're encouraged to call in with your comments to 610-378-0426.
And why not salute BCTV for all the great shows it provides to Reading and Berks? Send a check for $36 a year for a year's membership. Make your check payable to BCTV, 645 Penn Street, Reading, Pennsylvania, 19601. Remember, time passes, but operating expenses never go away.
And you can save a dollar and go buy some M&Ms. The membership is actually $35, but I'm sure they wouldn't mind you overpaying.
It said 36 on the screen.
It said
35.
Did it say?
Yeah.
Okay. I wondered about that.
That's all right.
Okay.
I'm sure they will appreciate the access.
Let's begin today's program with some views. I continue the rare collection of Reading area pictures introduced 2 months ago. We're pleased to comment that we've received some wonderful replies from viewers regarding the collection now being presented. All right, if we may have the first one. I believe this is where we might have stopped the last time. When you drive south on Route 10 and you pass Angelica Park, there was an Iron Truss Bridge. Do you remember the Iron Truss Bridge? Was that gone before your time?
Probably a bit before my time.
Okay. You remember that, John, the Iron Truss?
No, I don't.
Don't
I'm
you
sorry.
Really? Okay. Well, I remember the Iron Truss Bridge on Route 10, and I'm sure there are home viewers who remember the Iron Truss Bridge. You know, we had so many of those at one time, and little by little, they're disappearing. Of course, the one up in Bern, Village of Bern, is scheduled to go. We lost all the ones in the Blue Marsh area. Anyhow, there were the bridges over what had been the dam breast of Lake Angelica, which, of course, was established for sanitary ice. You know, when you went out and you cut water from a pond, I often wondered just what the level of sanitation really was, because every once in a while you might get a dead tadpole or something. But anyhow, yeah, for sure. And on the lower side of that dam breast was this mill. I know very little about this mill. I researched extensively and came up with virtually nothing about this thing. when I went there years back, I found some stones lying on the other side that probably were from this thing. But, oh, look, you can see the Iron Truss Bridge above it.
Mm-hmm. Above it, yeah.
Yeah, you can. So now we know where it was. Anyhow, that was Angelica. Am I having vision? Okay. Rare picture. When this appeared in the Passing Scene book quite a number of years back, there was a lot of interest. The Robinson Friends Meeting House. When you would go south out of Birdsboro, was that Route 82?
It was 82.
Okay.
Towards Geigertown?
That's it. And you would go southward and you would come to the Robinson Friends Meeting House. I was there with Tony Matassa, a good friend and a member of the Historical Society, about a year or so ago, to look for a grave site. And indeed, we did find the grave site. The Goosebone Man lies buried right behind that meeting house. The meeting house in later years was converted to a farm building after it was abandoned. And it was a chicken house for a while. And I can remember when the walls were still standing, but the roof was gone. And if you go there today, the meeting house is virtually all gone. There are stones that sort of form one of the walls. Like the part of the back wall is still standing, but what you see there no longer exists. That was a fairly sizable meeting house. Berks County had, of course, the one out at Kins Corner in Ottawa, the meeting house. And you have Exeter Friends Meeting House, you had Robinson Meeting House, and you had Reading Meeting House, which of course still survives, but that is a newer building. That was built in 1868. It used to be where the Madison, or the old Metropolitan Edison building, stood on Washington Street between 4th and Madison Avenue. And it fronted on Madison. It was a small building. The termites got the better of it, so they came up and they built between Trinity Lutheran Church and what we remember as the Raja Theater, or the Sovereign Performing Arts Center. People don't realize that when they walk up 6th Street past Trinity and they look to the left, heading towards the theater, and they see the Reading Friends Meeting House. By the way, that's a fascinating place inside. That is, I don't think they've done very much since 1868. It's a really, really neat building. That what you see in the front and where the cars park in the back was cemetery. The last person buried there was a teenager who died by an accident, and that was the last person buried there. Anyhow, so there was a cemetery. As a matter of fact, from Washington to Walnut and halfway down the block heading northward, and on the other side of the street where First Reformed churches, over that whole block where St. Paul's was later built and the Community General Hospital, now St. Joe's, that was all cemetery, that was buried full. And quite a number of those burials, the Raja Theater, the Sovereign Performing Arts Center, sits on a cemetery. And most of those burials were removed, cough, cough, out to Charles Evans Cemetery. Mm-hmm. They didn't quite all get there. But anyhow, those both sides of North 6th Street between Washington and Walnut were buried full at one time, and on the west side, halfway down that block. As a matter of fact, I had a friend who was on the consistory of St. John's German Lutheran Church, and when they dug down in that yard in the front to run a sewer pipe, what, 30 years ago, 35 years ago, they discovered that indeed there were burials on the right-hand side of that church, because they encountered some, as I recall.
Fine Hartman's Hotel.
I don't see Blind Hartman's Hotel. That looks to me like that might have been taken down off this.
It's like a sluice pipe or drainage.
You know what? Why does that say Blind Hartman's Hotel? That's obviously mislabeled.
Walt will have a word with the gentleman who put the slides together.
Yes. That was Miller's Lock. The final lock on the Union Canal after the flood of 1850 was Miller's Lock, and that was sort of behind the Victory Emmanuel Club. If you were to go back through the woods and down to the Schuylkill, you would have come to Miller's Lock. And I think that's why that says Brian Hartman's. I honestly forget. Oh, the picture underneath in the old photograph album was Brian Hartman's hotel. I forgot about that. Yeah. You know that one time there was a blind, can you imagine this in today's politically correct world, Brian Hartman had a post office, and the postal cancellation was Brian Hartman's. Can you imagine that today, having a post office called Brian Hartman's Post Office?
How could he see it, though, to cancel it?
Oh, God.
I think he was rather inactive by the time that came into effect. What happened was his hotel was really a log building, and that was replaced with sort of what's there today when you go the Pricetown Road, the new building that that was built on the site of Brian Hartman's, which they modified several years ago. But that's part of Miller's Lock. Let me see what the next picture is. Geez, I forgot about some of these. Okay, that was a hermit. And you can see his rather modest abode there. It reminds you of a collier's hut. So that's something you would have seen down at Hopewell, or with that, with our friend up in the Blue Mountains, but that was a collier's hut, is what that was, and it was taken over as a residence. Oh. That is a neat picture. That is a really neat picture. Can you imagine where that was taken?
Near Carsonia.
Yep. Carsonia had that little train, and it ran from, in later years, the carousel back to the Carsonia Inn, which was an old farmhouse back to the 1770s, I guess. It was what they called the Custer Farmhouse. I remember when they tore that down after the park closed. Well, actually, that was torn down before the park closed. The park closed in 1950, but that picture was taken back along that railroad. By the way, the train only ran one way, so you went forward to the hotel, then you back down to the point of beginning because there was no Y there, or there was no turntable. But that was taken at Carsonia Park. That is a neat, rare picture. I'm trying to remember if I ever used that in one of my books. Okay. That was on Penn Street, folks. That was, let me see, that would be some of the older folks in the audience. At 8th and Penn on the south side, you might remember there was a place where they sold linoleum prior to the time they tore down the old hardware store. And next door to that in later years had been Zesbitt's. And when this was taken, this would have been the third property up. That was a very ancient log building that was taken. They took that down when they put up the Hershey factory. You know, Milton Hershey was on Penn Street for a while. People forget that. He was only there a year and a half. And I researched it. Why can't I find Milton Hershey in the old directories? Why cannot I find anything? And the reason I couldn't find it was he didn't have the property in his name, and it traded under the Lancaster Caramel Company. No wonder I couldn't find Milton Hershey's chocolate factory on Penn Street. But that was the answer. That building has been gone for a long, long time. Okay, that was, I'm being surprised at these slides because I didn't remember that those were in there.
That shows you how long since we've seen them.
Yes. I know where that was. That was along the Schuylkill River at what was once called the settlement of Kissinger. When you went down Schuylkill Avenue years ago to the bridge, Kissinger's Bridge, you had a little settlement down there called Kissinger. You had the Kissinger Hotel. You had a mattress factory down there. And, of course, on that site today is an abandoned hotel building that used to be called the Redinger Cronkite Versammlung. And when I drove by the last time several years back, the building was unoccupied. And to the immediate left of it is the last barn in the city of Reading, down there on Spring Street. And that was down there at the foot of Kissinger Street. You used to cross the Kissinger's covered bridge and climb the hill, and you would wind up at the House of Good Shepherd. also known as Marymount on the Schuylkill, but that's where that was taken. You can tell those kids got a lot of exercise. Not a chubby one among them. Okay, Joshua, I think we're going to take a little break.
Okay.
And I haven't seen those slides, I bet you, in 25 years. What a surprise that was. Anyhow, Joshua?
Sure. Well, if you've been around the neighborhood this past Saturday or yesterday or even today, we've probably been resembling a used car lot. We've been taking apart our racing exhibit. It's closed this past Saturday on June 2nd. We just wanted to thank all our lenders for making that possible, and of course thank our good friends at Penske Truck Leasing and also the late Senator Opaque's office for helping to make that exhibit possible. Our next exhibit is going to open on Saturday, June 30th. It's going to be our Civil War exhibit. We're going to be doing this in a couple different phases here. The first phase is going to be talking about the first four phases of the four firsts of Berks County. We have the first flag, which you'll see. I think we're going to have a look at the graphic first, actually, our postcard, which hopefully you should have received today. This flag, that's one of the four firsts. This was the first American flag carried into Washington, D.C. by the first defenders, the Ringgold Light Artillery. It's in the collection of the Capitol Preservation Committee. They were very nice. We were able to get a really nice digital image of it, but the flag is about 10 feet by 17 feet or some very, very large size. And due to its size and its condition, we weren't actually able to borrow the flag itself. But the flag is one of the four firsts, along with the Ringgold Band, the Ladies Aid Society, and of course the Ringgold Artillery themselves, the first defenders. We'll be talking about the four firsts, the election of 1860. We're also going to have a period life component from that period, along with a lot of landmark moments in national history up to that time, thanks to Kim's diligent research. And we'd like to thank our friends at the Berks County Commission for Women for being our underwriting sponsor for that. On Saturday the 30th, there's many things going on the day itself. At 10 a.m., we have Steve Anderson from the Pennsylvania Humanities Council presenting Homegrown Heroes, Pennsylvania Communities in the Civil War. That'll be our second Saturday and also our exhibit opening program, which is free and open to the public. And that same day, we'll also be having a Charles Evans Cemetery walking tour, Remembrance of Civil War Heroes, conducted by Civil War Authority and reenactor Mark Flum. That'll be at noon. Gather at the Center Avenue entrance of Charles Evans Cemetery, right across from the Sterling Guest Hotel. But both of those programs are free and open to the public.
What's that date?
Saturday, June 30th.
June 30th.
Also, at 9 o'clock that very day, again Saturday, June 30th, we'll be having the opening of our Civil War, our collaborative effort between the Historical Society of Berks County, the Greater Reading and Convention and Visitors Bureau, and the Kutztown Folk Festival. We were able to have the Pennsylvania Road trailer. We have their website pulled up here. This is about a 53-foot long exhibition trailer. It might not look like much from the photos, but the side of it telescopes out, much like a camping vehicle. And you can see some interior shots there. It's about 1,000 square feet of exhibit space. And I've seen some tremendous pictures. You can see a couple of thumbnails at the top left there. But that's going to be at the Kutztown Folk Festival from Saturday, June 30th through July 8th. And as long as the weather providing, it'll be open every day of the show from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. One of the neater components of the trailer is, as part of the 150th effort, they're looking to document on a video camera, they've got a little booth in there, not only family history, but they've been really trying to push for getting video documentation of how the person coming to the exhibit, how they got interested in the Civil War, and how what they thought of the trailer. So that's a huge component of that, and we're very happy to be partnering with the Convention and Visitors Bureau and also the Kutztown Folk Festival to make that possible. The Kutztown Folk Festival itself is $14 or $3 off if you bring a little coupon here from their brochure. But admission to the trailer, once you're in the festival, it's free itself. And we're very happy to be part of that. Also, even before that, as sort of a prequel to our Civil War exhibit show, John Bartley and the kind folks at Oley Valley Antique Enterprises have enjoyed us back for our second year to be the featured guest for their 8th year Antiques in the Valley coming up on the 15th and 16th of this month at the Oley Valley Middle School. They do quite an amazing transformation. We go from a middle school to an antique gallery, and John's here to tell us a bit more about it.
Yes, I certainly loved it. First of all, I want to thank the Historical Society and BCTV for having me on tonight. It's a pleasure. I've always admired the Historical Society. We've lived in the Oley Valley for 35 years and always thought of them as just fantastic. I think it's one of the best historical societies probably on the East Coast, if not the country.
Thank you, John.
Very much admired.
No doubt about that.
I'll go on. Antiques in the Valley was organized by five couples from Berks and the Oley Valley area.
John and his wife being one of them?
I am one of them, yes. My wife and I. The show is June 15th from 11 to 7. That's a Friday. And June 16th on a Saturday from 10 to 4. And we're also going to have the Historical Society there to talk about the show and have an exhibit there also of different things from the Civil War and other items that they have currently on display. I'm not sure that's going to be on Berks County Art or what you
were
going to
be bringing certainly items from our Civil War exhibit coming up, and certainly not all the items in our little display there will be in the first phase of the exhibit, but we'll also be bringing a number of art pieces up there as well. Our other special exhibit right now is barnyard animal art, and there's a wide variety of topics we could do in the future, so it's always our pleasure to bring more artifacts that people don't get to see on a regular basis.
If you don't bring what you don't bring this year, hopefully you can do that next year.
Exactly.
As Josh said, this is our 8th year. It is held at the Oley Valley Middle School on Friedensburg Road. And the organizers, the five couples that originally organized the show, felt that the Oley Valley was just the perfect place to have a show. It's a rich heritage. It's a cultural presence. It's just the perfect place. The community, the school has been very receptive. They're all great help to us. There will be, I would say, probably 50 to 60 dealers coming from an 8-state area, from Vermont, from Ohio, certainly many from Pennsylvania, Maryland. They all collect their things during the year and save them to bring them to the Oley Valley. These are high-end dealers. This is what's called a walled show. Room settings, it should be very attractive. The dealers will be bringing furniture, folk art, textiles, jewelry, china, early glassware, ceramics, redware, and many of the dealers save items that are indigenous or from the Berks County area to antiques that they will be selling there at the show also. Admission price is $10, which includes the show admission, seeing all the dealers, and also the things that the Berks County Historical Society will be on display. And you will be having, I believe, a lecture on some subject on Friday in the afternoon, probably, and also one on Saturday afternoon.
Yep. Tell us about the portion of the proceeds, because I think that's awfully nice, and I don't think many people realize that.
For the past 8 years, we have given a major portion of the proceeds after expenses to the Oley Valley High School for honoring scholarships. It's given to the foundation group there. So we've been able to, over the past 8 years, or approximately $22,000 to scholarships to Oley Valley students.
That's great.
That is great.
Yeah, it's very satisfying. It really is. What more I can say? I'm not sure at this point. Maybe something will come up, or Josh may have some questions or some other.
Tell us about the trailer you bring in, because this is neat, too. Obviously, this is middle of June, and the school is not air-conditioned until they bring a trailer by and air-condition the school.
Well,
or is the gymnasium?
That has always been a big problem. Over the past 7 years, we have brought a huge trailer in at a great expense to air condition the gym. This year, we decided to cooperate and actually purchase the air conditioning and put that in the school.
Oh, wow.
So that that won't have to be done anymore. It has been a big expense too, but also much less than it would be to bring in that trailer and also supply the gasoline to run the generator. So it's
I'm sure the students thank you.
The students do thank us, yes.
I was either going to say that, or maybe you could get a sports team in the process of conditioning for fall sports so you can get them to run on fans, sort of a fan system.
Good idea, Josh.
But thank you ever so much for having us again, John. It's our pleasure to be your featured guest.
Well, thank you. We're
that's
very
awfully
proud
kind
to be,
of you.
Be working with you.
Thank you.
Let me remind people that Oley Township is the only township in the entire United States that is, as an entire entity, mm-hmm. on the National Register of Historic Places. That's really a major distinction for Oley Township.
Yes.
The heart of the Oley Valley.
Yes, it is.
Thank you again, John, very much.
Thank you.
Anything you're ready to pick up?
Oh, sure.
Okay, we can have some more pictures then. Okay, we should have some very interesting things coming up.
Fifth and Penn.
Yes, it is Fifth and Penn. And you notice the bus there. There we see Whitner's in the background. And, of course, Far Shoe. We see the top of the Far Shoe Store building. And on the corner was what was one time called the Fashion Store. That, of course, was all taken away a number of years ago when a bank building was put on that site. But we're looking down Penn Street to Fourth and Penn. To where the Reading Times was printed very early in its career. Let's go on ahead.
Pomeroy's,
yes.
Post-World War II?
They were working on that building. No, that's earlier than that. And in point of fact, let me think. That looks to me as though they're building that on the corner, and that would have been the year 1900. Mm. Now they did, in the 50s, late 50s, they changed the first two floors to make it look like a more modern store. They changed, they altered the window line and all that sort of thing. But no, that was the year 1900, because if you look on the left-hand side, the 1884 original DPNS store is visible. That later on in the 1920s was taken away. First, they built this new part. Then they tore down an old bank building and a saddlery building on to the left of that building that you see, and that became another new part of Pomeroy's. And then the last thing they did was got rid of the 1884 building, so that you had the Pomeroy's that some of us remember was actually composed of three separate structures built at different times. And that is the 19. Do we still have that big Pomeroy sign? No, the Heisman building is signed down in the cellar.
We do, but it's not in the basement. It's somewhere else.
Oh, somewhere, okay. Yep. For years, people walked by the building and they looked up. It was called the Heisman Corner because years back, the Heisman family owned that corner. As a matter of fact, the Heisman family owned that corner for many, many years. In the year 1900, they got a 99-year lease on that corner, and many of us wondered what would happen in 1999. Would they make them take the building away? But what happened was when Pomeroy's went out of business and they sold the thing to Allied Stores, there was a legal transfer and they actually acquired that lease, so that at the time that the building was taken down, it was no longer in the Heisman family. I remember Angela Heisman saying to me years ago, in 1900 they had a deal with DPNS, they would get so much, because they continued to own the land, but DPNS put up the building. And when they signed that deal in 1900, that seemed like such a lucrative, wonderful thing for the family. But the rent stayed the same for all those years. And what was big money in 1900 wasn't nearly as impressive in 1970. But they continued to pay that same amount of money. Some of us remember going down South 6th Street there on the right-hand side. There were a number of separate buildings that all comprised part of the Pomeroy complex. And one of those was the Heisman home. The Heismans had lived there years back. And then, of course, they later on went and built that nice place across from Holy Cross Memorial Methodist Church. That nice big brick house right directly across from that. That became the new Heisman home where they all lived until they died in extreme old age. Pomeroy's Corner. Kim, remember when we were coming in, I said, They used to have that nice little watch box there in the corner of 7th and Penn when the tracks ran through town. And that was what you're seeing there was the old hotel building, originally called the Railroad House. And later on, they tore that down and they put up a department store that for a long time was known as Reed's Department Store. And the watchman used to come out of his little building there on the corner, and he would raise and lower the gates in the days before the automatic lowering and raising of the... and people used to get so provoked. You know, things would be during the rush hour. Don would go those gates, and the cars would be backed up all the way to the Penn Street Bridge and all the way up to City Park, and they would wait to get through. There was a movement years ago, prior to the time that a lot of the traffic left Penn Street, to either tunnel below or build up over the top. They preferred the idea of tunneling below, something like the Spring Street subway, but it never actually happened. We're looking at 7th and Penn. We're looking to the north side and the northeast corner where the Kemmel cigarette ad is. Many of us remember Reed's Department Store. As a kid, I used to look in those windows and wonder how, even as a child, how did they make a go of it? They'd have one of these great big windows and they had one dress. And I think myself, you know, couldn't they do better than that? Anyhow, that was Reed's Department Store. Well, we're up in City Park and we have the Elk statue. The Elk statue was put up in the 1890s. It was made locally. Let me see. Brunicardi. Brunicardi designed.
Oreste
Brunicardi designed that thing, and we often wondered what happened to it. They had a system that took the water to the second floor of a brick building in the park, and the water came down through a sand filtering system by gravity, and it flowed underneath. And for a while, they had an arrangement there where they could lift a lid and put ice. So that you could go to a city park and get filtered iced water, which was a great big thing. The Reading Eagle in about 1907 sent someone out on a Sunday, and I forget how many thousand people he counted that went up to get a drink of this filtered iced water at the Elk Fountain.
How many tadpoles did he find?
I don't know.
Are they holding cups?
Yes. Mm. Now, originally, they used to have tin cups chained to those standards that you see there. We don't do that sort of thing today. Yes, there was the era before trench mouth. But anyhow, they had tin cups there. And then later on, they had like a bubbling arrangement. There were two places in Reading where you could get iced water. Where was the other place?
Fifth and Penn.
The WCTU fountain.
That's still there.
That's still there, but moved and no longer dispensing water. That fountain at 6th and Penn provided water at three different places in that fountain. Facing the sidewalk was for the people. The water ran out to the back of the thing for the horses to drink, and then it ran down to the bottom for cats and dogs to drink. Mm. It was nice ice water by the thanks of the ladies of the WCTU.
Anything to keep them from drinking.
That's right. I always thought that was a crime that
Temperance Society?
That at 5th and Franklin, the old WCTU temple was, after the Stauffer building was sold off, it became a tap room.
Justice.
That seemed like a real sacrilege.
Justice.
But anyhow, that's the fountain. In later years, that poor deer, the elk wound up without a pedestal. That was other part was taken away. A lot of the ironwork, they had wonderful iron fountains. They went in the scrap drive of World War II. A lot of those things were taken away. So that, I can remember as a kid during the war, you'd go up Penn Street and they would have movie nights where you had to bring a pot or a pan or something to get into the movie theater. And I can remember in front of the Astor Theater, they had a pile of pots and pans and an Edison horn. That pile must have been 9 feet high. Huge pile. So the movie was free, but you had to bring a substantial amount of metal. And a lot of the old pots and pans and whatever wound up in the scrap drive of World War II. And that's what happened to a lot of those fountains up in the City of Park.
Well, the cemetery ironwork, too, like around gates.
Yeah, a lot of that stuff went for the war effort. A matter of fact, you know, if you didn't give to the war effort and you had scrap lying around, your neighbor soon told you about it. I mean, people forget what the mentality was like, what the feeling was like during World War II. It was really... Well, this was taken from what would today be the 13th Street Extension. Only when this picture was taken, there was no 13th Street Extension. I remember years back, 13th Street ended at the end, at the south end of St. Joe's Hospital. And then you went down and drove around through the park. And then later on, they extended. I often wondered why 13th Street all of a sudden changed names. And the answer was the one street, and what was the name of that street up there when you... past the front of Central Catholic High School. Ugh.
Oh, yeah. Hill?
Hill?
No, the
Climber.
Climber, yeah. Heister Climber. I'll say the politician. Yeah, all of a sudden, 13th Street becomes Climber. How can that possibly be? Well, the answer was Climber existed, and so did 13th Street. But then when they extended 13th Street, it ran into Climber, and all of a sudden, Shazam, it was Climber. We're looking down, and you see that very decided oval, which was the old racetrack in City Park. When they stopped, when they took the fair out of City Park in, 1887, because there was no fair in 88. In 1887, they took the fair out of there and the horse racing stopped, but that became a very popular venue for the bicycles. And there we have the 1893, 94. In the 1890s, they put... they started a park commission, and they improved the section very close to Kesher Zion Synagogue. That used to be a big weed patch over in that general part of the park. And, of course, Gallows Hill was over there, and that's when they leveled off Gallows Hill. There was also a cemetery over there, a Potter's Field, and that was eliminated. The poor get no problem. but anyhow, there is the old greenhouse. Now, what you see there doesn't exist today. It was designed by Alexander Forbes Smith, and it was a structural steel thing, and with all the humidity in that building.
Rust.
Yeah, and they had to replace that. But that the greenhouse, of course, still does survive. But that City Park, looking down from... there was like a bicycle trail, a path that used to go across and go over to Climber, and that was later developed into the 13th Street Extension. What am I looking at? We're looking at the fairgrounds. They moved because of a court action, the city, the Penn's Commons was for the recreation of the public, and they didn't want anything in that park the people couldn't enjoy every square inch of that land up there. So they moved the fair out of there, and they moved it over to the property generally occupied today by the post office there at Albright College. What is now post office ground used to be fairground. And from 1888 until 1914, that was the fairgrounds. In 1915, they opened the new fairgrounds in Muhlenberg Township, when the Reading Fair was in Muhlenberg Township. And what you're seeing there is the...
does that say Northeastern Lumber Company?
Yeah. What happened was, after they moved to the fair, out to Muhlenberg Township, then they sold that property off and it became Northeastern Lumber Company. And the old Fairground Hotel became the main office building for the lumber yard. I remember when that office building, I remember buying lumber up there, and you paid in the old hotel building.
I think we have a neat old aerial shot of that same property.
Let's take a little break. I believe there's a message of some sort.
You're watching the Historical Society of Berks County on bctv.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For other information on local heritage societies and local history, go to bctv.org. The Historical Society of Berks County on bctv.org is underwritten by the Highlands. To find out how you and your business can support a program on BCTV, go to bctv.org.
Okay, now when you cross the street from the old Fairgrounds Hotel building, you could get a bit of a beverage on the other side of the other side of the street, because the Deppens, the German brewery was up there. It went by three or four different names over the years, and of course later on it wound up in the hands of
Max Hassel.
Yes. I love those old Max Hassel brewery stories, where they would put a federal guard there to watch, and when they were ready to move product out, someone would go out and whisper, and he'd turn his back. So he saw nothing, and he heard nothing, and they'd roll the barrels right out behind him. But anyhow, the brewery was across the street. It was a big brewery mansion that stood on the corner. The folks who remember the old trolley barn, I believe there's a credit union building now at that site, but there was a big mansion that used to sit there, which was the brewer's mansion for the brewery right across the street. I remember I wrote a story about the old fairgrounds up here on 11th Street. And 2 weeks later, there was a labor problem, and the main exhibition hall burned to the ground. And then the Reading Eagle, 2 weeks later, wrote a story at the time that it burned, wondering what that building was. After I had written the story 2 weeks before, and it took the first page of Section B. Apparently, they didn't read my story, but anyhow, those things happen. Oh, there we are. We're inside. That was the hotel building at the old fairgrounds from 1888 until 1914. That was the office. I remember that office in there. You'd go in to pay your bills. Rather handsome. Northeastern Lumber Company, of course, occupied that almost up until the time that the post office was built. That was part of... Okay, I don't know whether you recognize that this was being built, I'm going to guess, was it 1927, 1928? That's the Lindbergh Viaduct. And you see that the gravity track is running back there to the one building, and there's some kids. That was the building of the Lindbergh Viaduct. By the way, right on this site used to be a reservoir, Mineral Spring Reservoir Number 2, which supplied water to the city of Reading. And then later on, when they started the Pandora Zoo, they actually had swans in that pond. And then later on, that was filled in, and of course, that's all gone today. That's the Mineral Spring Park Hotel. By the way, I just bought a stereo view that is extraordinary, one that I had never seen before, and it actually shows a second pond in that stereo view, taken by Fred Yeager a long time ago. That's the Mineral Spring Park Hotel, opened about 1814, originally built as a hosiery mill. It operated for about a year and three quarters, and it was converted to a hotel complex. And there you have the Rose Valley Creek, Rosenthal Valley, and that creek used to run down through the city of Reading, meander around on the surface, and at various places in the city of Reading, there were little bridges across the street, to get from one side of the street to the other. Needless to say, that was a mild impediment to the development of certain parts of the city of Reading. And eventually, they built that tunnel that goes from Pandora Park underground all the way southwest in Reading and empties out into the Schuylkill River. The painting that we have at the Historical Society above the card catalog, that Devlin, shows where that water came out years ago.
Furnace, yeah.
Yeah, the furnace.
Eckert?
Yes.
Hampton, sorry.
Yeah, the Fire Chief Rare was down there taking some pictures. We had gone down there recently to see where that water emptied out into the Schuylkill. And of course, it still empties out into the Schuylkill because that water has to go someplace. And that was Rose Valley Creek, or Rosenthal. Interesting thing, it does lie in that little glen, and we all know about Mount Penn, but on the other side of that glen, it wasn't Mount Penn. All the old maps show that as Mount Washington. Mount Washington was between that creek and the Friedensburg Road. That mountain there was not Mount Penn in the old maps. Today, everyone calls that Mount Penn. Well, originally that was Mount Washington, but they changed the name to honor the father of our country, I presume. Anyhow, we're looking down towards, we would be looking, what, westward, I guess, from the Mineral Spring Park Hotel. Back in the 1930s, they leased that to the East Ends, and that is now the East End Club. There is your Mineral Spring. That is a very, very old picture. You know, years ago, they had great faith in the healing properties of pure water with lots of wonderful minerals, and there they are partaking of those minerals. That little pavilion has been gone for a long, long time. That is the only picture that I know to exist of that. Let's take a little break. Do you have something to tell us, Kim?
Well, we still have some events coming up.
Oh, by all means.
First and foremost, I think Simon would want us to mention that last Friday, June 1st, we hosted our annual fundraiser at Stokesay Castle. This year's event celebrated John Philip Sousa's Golden Jubilee, featuring the Ringgold Band. We would all like to thank the Ringgold Band, James Seidel, there's been discussion, guest conductor Colonel Timothy Foley, and John Philip Sousa IV for making the night an event to remember. The only thing missing was the fireworks, which we couldn't have because of the downpour and tornado warnings. We'd also like to thank the following sponsors for making the night happen. Our signature sponsor, Stone Ridge Retirement Community, Middleton Kreitz & Associates, William G. Cuck & Associates, the Highlands, National Penn Investors Trust, Customers Bank, and Winehammer. We also would like to thank Associated Construction, Wirt Investment Consulting Group, Phoebe Berks Village, Vist Financial, Reading Eagle Company, and Reading Bakery Systems for sponsoring the event. It was fun had by all, and the dinner was excellent.
It was a great evening at Stokesay.
I didn't know what Red Snapper was beforehand, but I do now, and I love it.
That's Red Snapper. Wonderful meal at Stokesay. Wonderful. By the way, again, we want to thank the Highlands of Wyomissing. They were sponsors, one of the sponsors of that affair, and they have been sponsoring this program, people. They've been underwriting this program for quite a number of years, and we honestly, sincerely appreciate the Highlands of Wyomissing for their interest in local history.
And while we're on the subject of John Philip Sousa, Rachel Erb, one of our donors, donated this, which is deemed to be the last signature of John Philip Sousa, a few hours. We're playing musical
Elusive fellow, isn't it?
It was procured by Andrew Fisher, who was Rachel's father. And we had this on display. It's down at the bottom. There we go. It's pretty good. Doing it backwards. So this is now a wonderful part of our collection.
It's a great piece. Yeah. And we thank Rachel Herb for that.
She's down in South Carolina.
Rachel is?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that. She was a member of Music Club years ago.
Mm-hmm. Also, this coming Saturday, June 9th, is our second Saturday program on The World of Charles Evans, presented by Michelle Lynch. It states that Charles Evans was born in 1768 and died in 1847, and his lifetime, he spanned the colonial and Victorian eras, including, and got to see the change from agricultural to the Industrial Revolution. The program, well, the pre-program, which is all the hors d'oeuvres, your morning breakfast, starts at 9:30. The program begins at 10. Members are free, and non-members are asked to pay $5.
You know, that's going to be a wonderful trip. And Michelle knows that cemetery better than anyone else alive. And when she does a cemetery tour, it is genuinely worth taking. That will be a great tour. It really will be.
I believe we're staying in the building now for the tour.
Yeah, we're not doing... Oh, aren't we? She's not doing the walking
tour. What's she doing with slides?
I believe so.
It'll still be an excellent program.
Yep.
Oh, that's great because we won't have to walk that great distance. That'll be nice.
Well, and with the rain we've been having. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's going to be a beautiful day Saturday.
It is?
Oh, my goodness. It's going to be a glorious day. Friday, Saturday, and Sunday.
It's supposed to get very warm, though.
Well, that too.
All right. Also coming up on June 23rd is our summer picnic up at the Reading Liederkranz. I know we have graphics for that. Did you give it to them?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. Yay. Sweet. Join us up at the Reading Liederkranz, which is coincidentally right next to Stokesay. The picnic includes a German buffet, entertainment by Mr. Squeezebox Kermit Olinger, and the GTV Edelweiss. Okay, I can't pronounce that.
GTV Edelweiss.
Schuhplotters.
Janice, we apologize.
Yeah, sorry, Janice. The event starts at 5 p.m. The cost of a ticket is $35. Children ages 6 to 12 or 14, please call the Historical Society at 610-375-4375 for more information and to reserve your ticket or visit our website.
The food will be fabulous. And yes, that's a nice beer garden in the background. And they have a nice pavilion, shaded, nice pavilion with a roof over the top. That's a beautiful place back there for a picnic.
Well, how can you not have a good time up at the Liederkranz?
That's true.
Exactly.
I've been to Oktoberfest. You have to go at least once.
Mm-hmm.
I got it in early. Okay, I mean, we have one more event coming up, but this is more for the library. Well, it's a library-sponsored program. Trying to piggyback on the success of the archival workshop series, we are trying to institute a book club, our very first ever, and not to be confused with the public library. It's going to be more historic in nature, and for the very first book, we decided to test the waters, and we will be doing Francis Hoover's Enemy in the Rear, which was published in 1895. I've been telling everybody, and it's pretty much close to accurate, that it's kind of like the tell-all book on Berks County and centering on Wernersville during the Civil War. I brought one. We do have at least two of the first editions. This is actually, I believe this one was, if not this one, the other one was signed by Francis Hoover. Interesting Berks County connection. He wrote the book in Rushville, New York, which is up around Rochester, New York, and then ended up shortly after that moving to Lockport, New York, which is where I'm from. And he spent his days as editor of the local newspaper, and he died up there. He's buried up there.
I didn't know that. Yeah. Editor of the paper.
Editor of the
didn't
paper.
Know that.
And
he was a minister. He was pastor at Freedom's Independent Church.
Yeah, and he was minister at
St.
John's in Gibraltar, yeah, and Plowville and all in that area, mm, too. So we'll real quick, we have a home viewer.
We have a home viewer. Yes, home viewer. You're on.
My name's Joanne.
Yes, Joanne.
And I would like to know if you have any... pictures from back in the 50s on Penn Street?
The answer is yes. As a matter of fact, in one of the passing scene books, there's a collection there from the 1950s. The person who took them originally started on one side of the street, went up and photographed virtually every building, and came down the other side. That is available in the library of the Historical Society. It's in one of the passing scenes, like maybe 7, 8, or 9, one of those. Yes, the answer is yes. Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Does that answer your question?
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Kim?
Okay. This book was so kind of despised by Berks Countyans that they actually tried to burn up every copy that they got, which is why we decided we'd start off with this book. It's actually quite fascinating and a little funny, too. The best part about this book is for the introduction to the book club. You can actually download this book for free to your Kindle, iPhone. I have mine on my Droid. You can download it to your computer and print it out.
That's neat that you can do that, because those books, have you checked the price of those lately?
No.
$600.
Yep.
$600 for a first edition. Well, he only did one edition because he made himself scarce after the first one.
Well, he wasn't even here when he wrote it.
I know. I can go into a long story about that, which is very interesting, about when W.W. Dietrich died in Kutztown, he had a box of those in the cellar.
Yeah.
And they were sold at auction. Oof.
Well, as part of the discussion for the book, we will bring out the Francis Hoover collection, which includes original handwritten letters by Francis Hoover and the key, which pairs up who the characters are with their real names.
There are two separate keys, and there's a slight difference between the two, but yep. They're available.
That will be on July 18th at 5:30. We're asking everybody to, wishing to participate, first off, to contact me so we know that you're coming. We're trying to arrange for space, and we're also asking a $5 donation for the Adopt-A-Collection program at the library.
And we have pictures, by the way, that accompany that book.
Yes, we do. And I know where those are, and we'll bring those out too. And then real quick before we run out of time, the very first brand new edition of the Historical Review, Donna Reed put in a chronology timeline that was developed by Dr. William Willits Hummel. The timeline stops about 2001, and I actually have it here. We actually had it bound. And we're kind of interested in finding some volunteers who would be interested in taking up Dr. Hummel's research and continuing on with the timeline and making it current and keeping it current so that we can use it in future editions of the Historical Review. Dr. Hummel was at one point the editor of the Historical Review, so it's kind of fitting that we include his work in the review right now. And so if anybody's interested, please contact us at the Historical Society, 610-375-4375, and ask for me, and we'll kind of get you set up. And if you're interested, we can add to this and keep Berks County's history going.
I never saw that book.
I bound it.
That
so,
explains it.
Yeah, so.
Okay. You do nice work.
Yeah.
Yes, you do nice
Thanks
work.
Thanks to DAG Bookbindery. No, it came in just in pages, so we bound it and put it on the shelf, and it's available to anybody who needs it.
Okay. We thank you, Kimberly. Tell your friends about our program, which is on live the first Wednesday of each month at 7. This program repeats this Friday night at 10, Saturday at 6, and Sunday morning at 9. Special announcement. Since the first Wednesday in July falls on Independence Day, there will be no Historical Society of Berks County program next month. We'll see you the first Wednesday in August, all smiles and full of information. Thanks to today's panel, Joshua Blay, Kimberly Richards, John Bartley,
Brown.
and John Bartley. I'm Joy Jedmeiser IX, your host and a 52-year member of the Historical Society. We look forward to having you join us again on the first Wednesday in August 2012. Thanks for watching. So long.